basically just has a small glimpse, I guess, into each of these so that a person can kind of get a quick understanding of, you know, what the theory behind it might be, and I guess leave the reader to figure out, you know, do their own research and decide for themselves. So today we're just going to read the introduction. So the author is John E. Lewis. He's a writer and historian. His many previous books include the best-selling The Mammoth Book of the Edge and The Mammoth Book of How It Happened, as well as The Everest and The Mammoth Book of Wild Journeys. So I guess Mammoth is his favorite word, but I think there was a magazine called Mammoth, which he might have been the editor of, or at least writer for, so I think that's why he's using that term. So there are all kinds of stories, but they're not particularly long. We're just going to read the introduction today, just to kind of give you an idea of this person's concept of conspiracy. So this is the boom time of conspiracy theory. 9/11, the war on terror, the death of Diana, Opus Dei, that was featured in Dan Brown's best-selling conspiracy novel, The Da Vinci Code. The list of conspiracies seemingly perpetuated by them against us goes on endlessly. More and more people subscribe to alternative histories of events, such as Michael Moore's celebrated documentary, Fahrenheit 9/11, and less do people accept the word of the establishment of government, business, or the church at face value. The conspiracy theory boom has been rolling towards us and gathering pace since the 22nd of November, 1963, when President John F. Kennedy was assassinated. That the most famous man in the world could be murdered in broad Texan sunlight by a lone gunman beggared belief. A sense of innocence was lost that day. It was beaten into oblivion by the succession of American figures who were also supposedly assassinated by lone gunmen: Robert F. Kennedy, Martin Luther King, and Malcolm X. The proof that there was something rotten in the state of Western politics came in the next decade, Watergate. Of course, there were conspiracies and assumed conspiracies before 1963. Some considered the Bolsheviks a product conception. Make up his or her own mind. It's only them corporations, whether it's media or the government, because they profit from these companies, people realize that, well, they might have a vested interest in pleasing these companies rather than actually telling the truth about a certain event, because the companies fund their careers. Otherwise, those newspapers wouldn't have any advertisers. Those government campaigns wouldn't have any money. So there's a lot behind it, and I think once that started to become evident, people started swaying towards alternative history, and that's the real reason. It's not so much because people just like different ideas, it's because it became obvious that there was a money game behind all of the institutionalized programs for providing information to the public. They were all somewhat biased because of how they were being funded, and the companies had a say in what was published and what was passed on to the public. And so people wanted alternative, versions of what was happening. A lot of times the stories just didn't make sense that were coming out on the news. And when people investigated a little bit, they realized, oh, there were certain companies involved with certain events, and that's possibly why a certain story was presented in one light rather than another. We're also exposed to a lot more. There are varying media outlets. We have cable TV, so we can see that the stories that come out of Russia or China or the Middle East or wherever are different from the stories that come out in the United States. The European press is different from North American press. So we have access to that information, and it kind of makes us question. I also have a feeling that there is a little bit of a push towards the conspiracy that is maybe even funded by the same people producing the issues in the first place, meaning there was, I guess, in the 1920s, people started realizing that the magazines, this was true in the movie industry, that, they used to have promotional magazines for whatever the films were, the movie stars and everything. They had, promotional magazines produced by the studios. Well, the studios also owned these tabloids and gossip magazines. Usually those were, pretty rough. A lot of times they were, I don't know how they would be described. I don't even think that stuff could be published nowadays, because it would just be like, wow, that's really over the top. But they were just like graphic, extremely graphic, kind of really dark in nature. There was a certain point when those started to make more money than the promotional magazines. So, when the glamour mags, where everybody's looking, primed and proper, were making less money than the, ragtag mags, where they were showing what these actors and actresses looked like when they were stumbling out of nightclubs and doing all of these other things. People were more interested in that. When that became a much bigger business, I think that there was an effort by the same publishing companies that were producing the mainstream newspapers to also produce this lower level stuff, where some of it was true, some of it wasn't, but it was making money. And so there might even be a continued effort in that arena. I mean, obviously there's still tabloids around, but there might be a continuing effort in that same vein, where there's like this concept that, okay, if the public image of government is one way, then the underbelly of it is going to be another way, and then the internet is like the best place to start to kind of provide that information. Some of it is true, some of it is not, but it attracts attention, similar to the way the tabloids used to. And a lot of these truther sites and even Godlike Productions, I think even David Icke's, whatever these different alternative sources are, a lot of them are funded by major companies too. So there is a business behind this conspiracy movement as well. It's kind of been going strong, I think, since the 60s. That was a good example that the assassination of John F. Kennedy spurred a tremendous amount of interest in alternative histories and trying to figure out what really happened. But since then, books have been coming out one after another, giving alternative versions of whatever the heck was going on at the time, whether it was Watergate or one assassination or another. There were books coming out talking about it, and then finally this term, the Illuminati, became a mainstream concept. I guess, I don't know if the first books were released in the 60s or 70s, but definitely by the 80s, 90s, and for sure by the 2000s, this became a common enough term that people were at least familiar with it. A person kind of has to question, was that presented to the public on purpose? Meaning, you know, this idea of a secret cabal makes sense, so people are automatically attracted to it. But it's also presented as this, like, you know, it's also like part of that they're selling the idea themselves, you know what I mean? So what I'm wondering is how much of that is a little bit of a gimmick and how much of it is true. I think everybody realizes when they see the mainstream stories and then they question the sort of validity of it, and then they look at the internet or these other sources for the alternative stories. The alternative ones at least give a little bit of reasoning as to why a lot of this stuff is happening. Most of the time it's money. Money is behind a lot of it. And, you know, most people are satisfied with that reasoning because it makes sense. But then there are extreme conspiracies which go beyond the money concept and get into, you know, other agendas. And I don't know if that's accurate, if there is something like that, or if that is being presented to the public purposefully, you know, so that it's something that we can focus on. And it's hard to say, because it seems like there is a push towards almost purposefully getting people to believe in this kind of thing. Like, you know, it's like there is a momentum behind it. And anytime there's money backing these things, you gotta kind of question, well, who's paying for this stuff? Who's paying for these productions and all of these different things? I mean, I was a major believer in all of this stuff. I still believe in a lot of these alternative histories and alternative theories, but I do question who is backing this information to come out, because truthfully, if there really is an evil cabal, they're never going to tell you what they're doing, but they will tell you what they want you to think. So I'm always, you know, nowadays anyway, I question even the alternative stuff, meaning that there's probably something behind that too. There might be an agenda even behind the presentation of the alternative stuff. In any case, a person should keep an open mind and should look at the clues, should look at the patterns that are presented, and, you know, figure things out for themselves. There's nothing wrong with looking at alternative theories or alternative histories to events, because there is truth in, even when people are lying, there's truth in the lies that they choose to tell. So you can still get information. You just have to have a keen eye and sort of think about it and do your research and sort of pay attention to the little details, because things are kind of given away in the small details. They sometimes give themselves away in terms of what is actually being promoted underneath the conspiracy, like what is the concept underneath it that is kind of being promoted just by even the publication of a certain piece of information. So it's good to look at this stuff. I don't think that a person should run from conspiracies. I don't really like that term. It really just means that people who are into alternative histories are just trying to figure out what the truth is. So they're just curious as to how something actually happened, because the official story doesn't totally make sense. So it's just a person with some keen awareness who wants to figure out the truth so that just wants to figure things out because we kind of come from a culture where we've always had a sort of, whether it's a dictator or a kingship or somebody as an overhead authority, an authoritarian figure, telling us the way that it is. As our society becomes more educated and people have less need of that authoritarian figure, we're just trying to figure out what's true and what's not. And it doesn't mean that a person is a theorist or, that there should be some negative association. It just means somebody who's trying to figure it out. And I think we're all in the same boat. So I will look through this book, and as we as you know, if I happen to have other material, I might add that in because these stories, I think they're only a page or two long, so they're kind of short. But if I do happen to have an article or something like, a book or something similar on the same topic, I might read from that as well when it's in the same line of discussion. Okay, guys, so this is the that was just the introduction for the Mammoth Book of Cover-ups, the 100 most disturbing conspiracies of all time. Hopefully they're not too disturbing, because I know people are